Hey folks, Scott Weingart here, and this is the MCrit Podcast. Today, we have a non-medical topic. The topic is creation of presentations. Everyone, whether in academics or community, at some point will have to give a presentation, whether it's to your co-faculty, your residents, medical students, etc. For the past 2 years, I've been speaking at the amazing teaching course run by Rob Rogers, Salim Rezier, Anand Swaminathan. And 2 years ago, I gave this talk and they gave me a 60-minute slot. It was an okay lecture. It was kind of tangential. People seemed to like it. But this year, they gave me 30 minutes. And at least from my impression, this lecture was so much better because, as always, when you reduce the time, people are forced to think. And you give a 60-minute lecture and you could just kind of wing it. You give a 5-minute lecture and you better practice that thing a couple thousand times. So this 30-minute lecture, I think, is a much better distillation of my ideas on the topic, and I hope you like it. Before we get there, I just want to advertise for some other great things coming out of the teaching course and Teaching Institute folks, because they were kind enough to let me post this lecture. I am speaking at the podcasting course in April with these guys. This is the first podcasting course out there for medical people. And if you're interested in starting a podcast or how it works, you should check out the course. They also have some other amazing offerings. You could check them out in the show notes at mcrit.org/192. Okay, let's get right to it. My lecture on PowerPoints and Meth from the teaching course, New York City. This is not a talk about slides. Slides are like the teeth of a meth addict. They are an external manifestation of a sickness. And getting this person incredible dental work does not change the fact that they still have a problem. So I'm not going to talk to you about slides. Because the problem of bad presentations goes much deeper. It's a problem in the roots. It's a problem in the fundamentals. And if you don't deal with those, then all of the slide design workshops in the world are not going to make the situation better. And it is a sickness, and we know in the States the way to cure a sickness is with a 12-step program. So that's what I'm going to give you today. The 12 steps to recovering from bad presentations. And you know step one, it's admitting you have a problem. I had a problem. I gave bad, bad talks. And you guys are lucky. There's books now. There's incredible blogs like Ross Fisher's. There's courses like this one. When I first started giving academic presentations, none of that stuff was really out there. There was a couple stuff, things on the fringe, but it was really tough to find. And I had to learn by screwing it up again and again and again until finally I kind of figured it out with the help of some of my friends. But I still have to admit I have a problem every time I give a talk. I have to admit that I can't create that talk the night before, that it's not acceptable to wing it. And admitting I have that problem is what keeps me caring, keeps me practicing. So that's step one. Step two is choosing your topic and your purpose. And you might say, well, I don't get to choose my topic. They handed me my topic. And it's not true. You always get to choose your topic. And you need to choose a topic that you're passionate about. If there's not passion, then your talk is flat. You know, I had a good friend of mine come and give grand rounds at our program a couple weeks ago. And she is an international class speaker on the topic of neurocritical care. And so I was super excited. And I showed up to the talk and she spoke to us about GI bleeds. And it was not a great talk. And I called her up afterwards. I'm like, you know, what's the deal? Why are you talking to us about GI bleeds? And she said, the program director said the block we're in is the GI block, so could you maybe give us a talk on GI? Never do that. Never fall for that trap. There's not a program director out there. If you say, look, my area of expertise is neurocritical care. I have an amazing talk on subarachnoid that's going to blow your residents away, and it's going to change the way they take care of these patients. There's not a program director out there who's going to say, oh, no, 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 you have to talk on gastric reflux. Not going to happen. So don't fall into that trap. But even if you're forced into a topic, you have full control of how you approach it, how you actually give that talk, and what you zone in on. and you need to zone in on something that interests you, that gets you excited. Otherwise, there's no point. And one of the ways you could do that is within any topic, the way to make it interesting is the same way you make a photograph interesting. You zoom in. In pretty much anything, if you're giving a broad overview of a topic, it's going to be boring. And I have my residents, they get 10 minutes after morbidity and mortality conferences to talk about some learning point. And if they try to give me the entire history, management, and diagnosis of sepsis in those 10 minutes, that's going to be horrible. But if instead they say, here's the newest evidence on which vasopressor to choose for a septic patient, all right, in 10 minutes, they're going to teach me something. It's interesting. So zoom in. And then this, does anyone know who penned this? If you don't know where you're going, any road will get you there. Anyone? Lewis Carroll, fantastic. Alice in Wonderland. And this quote is, it speaks to the fact that you need to figure out the purpose of giving your talk. And if the purpose of your talk is, well, they asked me to speak, so I gave a talk, well, you've already failed. At this stage, the conceptualization stage, you need to know what you want people to leave your talk with. And, you know, any of these could be an answer to what is your purpose, but this is not really ordered correctly. This is how it should look. Because if your lecture is not inspiring people, if your lecture is not inciting change, then what's the point? And then these others, they are all, other things you should search for. But the one I have crossed out at the bottom, educate, is usually, it's a failure to have that as your purpose for this kind of talk. Because you can't give the full, width, the full breadth of a topic in the course of a presentation. If you really wanted to educate, then you have people read articles or textbooks or listen to podcasts before the lecture, and then you use your hour to talk about the edge cases, the questions, the tough, challenging cases, and then all of a sudden people can be educated. But you can't educate in a talk like this. Maybe one or two points, but what you can do is inspire. What you can do is get people enthused to go and educate themselves, and that should be your purpose. So always inspire, and then figure out what else you want to do as well. And then the other part of topic and purpose is imagine who you're giving the talk to. It's a very different talk for first-year medical students than attendings who have been practicing for 20 years. And if you don't know who you want to hit, then you're going to hit no one very well. So, Rob, when I come to this course, he hands me this extensive demographic sheet with where you folks are from and what your professions are and what you sought to get out of this class. And no, Rob doesn't do that. But I wish he did, because then I would give a better talk. But you must envision who. And the way I envision who is, first, I envision my ideal audience member. And this is the person I'm gearing everything in my talk to specifically. And of course, it'll be a wider hit than that. But when I give grand rounds, for instance, I give my talk to a first-year attending. Because yes, I might go above the head of those first-year residents, but they'll strive to figure out what the hell I'm saying. But if I give a talk geared to that first-year resident, then everyone else in the room is like, I know this already. So that's my ideal audience member. And then you also envision the worst. The person you really do not want to show up to your talk. The person who's going to ask you the hard questions. The person that's going to make the derogatory comments. And you envision that person in your head as well. And by doing that, you precede the evil. You actually, in your talk, gear defense mechanisms to deal with that worst audience member. So by envisioning the ideal, envisioning the worst, all of a sudden your talk is now hitting the people that need to be hit. All right, so step three, create brainstorming spaces. What do I mean by this? As soon as I'm given the talk, I start thinking about the topic and the purpose. And then I create an idea space, a place where all of the musings about this talk could go. One place where I could put all the ideas of what I want to include and actually look at them every now and then. And so if it's a more creative talk, I'll put it in a mind map. And this could be on paper. I use an electronic version. But what a mind map allows you to do is stick everything that pops into your head into a place and then figure out the structure of it, how they fit together later on. Because you could just move the various words you put into a mind map anywhere you want, especially with these new versions on your iPad or on your computer. So I'll just throw everything in. If it's a more linear talk, if it's a more scientific talk, I'll put it in an outline. And it could be on paper, but again, I use an electronic version, so I can just throw it in there and then move these things around. And I do this the day I'm giving the talk, is I just create a space. Nothing's in there yet. But what this does to have a space for your ideas is to allow unconscious processing. And this is almost magic. What happens is, with no conscious thought at all, my brain starts working on the presentation. It starts thinking of things I could put in there. Oh, well, this would be a great way to talk about this. And I just throw those into the idea space. And I'm doing nothing else for this lecture at this stage, you know, maybe months ahead of time, except just letting my unconscious brain process this stuff. And for me, it's often in the shower. Oh, great idea. When I get out, I put it in the idea space. And I don't even bother looking at any of the other stuff that's there. I just throw it all in. And what you will find is if you let your mind have free rein, all the work will be done for you. That at the end, when you have to put the entire presentation together, you look at that idea space, you're like, oh my God, there's a lot of stuff here. And what you're doing now is just editing out, as opposed to having to reconceptualize. So allow that power of your unconscious brain to go to work for you. All right, and then the other thing I do is I just drag a folder onto my desktop, and I just title it the name of the talk, and that's gonna be the place where all of the cool pictures I come across, or PDFs, or videos, or links go. And as, you know, the weeks go by, all I'm doing is if I come across something, it goes in that folder. And my folder, and I'll have this for you after this talk, has subfolders with videos, you know, articles, images, and they're all there. And when I go to put the talk together, everything I need is right there in front of me. All right. Step four, choose a structure. Have a structure for your talk. You all have a structure for all your talks, but if it was done without thinking about it, then it's this structure. And that structure is the info dump. And the info dump is not the structure you want. You want to have something more crystallized. And there's plenty out there. There's the problem-solution structure. This is used in the business world all the time. Here's one of the challenges we face. Here's how we're going to deal with it. Here's our second challenge. That's fine. If you're in a debate, then line them up, shoot them down. Take all the arguments you anticipate your opponent is going to present, and then before they even get to them, precede them and say why they're wrong, and then put your own arguments up. Story arc, or the hero's journey. This has been proven over hundreds and hundreds of years to be an effective way to hit the human brain. Take a protagonist, introduce him or her, put them through a set of challenges, give a climax, and then a denouement. And this could be fit into your presentations. And here's the hint. If you want to use the story structure, make your audience the protagonist. Make it about them and allow them to go through the hero's journey. And all of a sudden, they're hooked. And every book you read, every TV show you watch, every movie you go to see, this is it. This is the structure. Chronological structure, if you want to deal with the history of medicine, then you take that structure, obviously. Top 10. For some reason, the number 10 resonates with the human brain. Or in this case, I'm giving you the top 12. If you can't figure out any other structure, just go for the rules of three. For some reason, three hits all our buttons. We like things in three. So figure out the three top things you didn't know about GI bleeding, or the diagnosis, management, and really challenging cases of GI bleeding. But anything in threes works out well. What this does is it introduces constraint. It forces you to gel your ideas into an architecture. But the other thing it does, and it's probably not on a conscious level, is your audience relaxes because they know, here's a structure I could put all this new knowledge into. You know, if I'm on step number four, you're gonna hear eight more steps about presentation creation. Whether you know it or not, that makes your brain happy. To know where you are, to know how much more is coming, to know, okay, here's a way I could actually process this information. Use those constraints to your advantage. And then rehearse. And you're gonna be doing it alone at this point. And here's a key, if you take nothing else from this talk, when you rehearse alone, you do it out loud. You say the words. You actually make the body motions. Because just doing it in your head, you know, flipping through your slides, oh yeah, here's what I'm gonna say here, that doesn't work. you don't actually have the same processing when you're thinking it as when you verbalize it. And when you start verbalizing and you do it again and again and again, those words start getting locked in. They start getting made better. And when you actually give the talk, you will be able to utilize all the experience you've had with verbalizing these ideas. Doing it in your head does nothing. So you need to be, you know, partially schizophrenic. You need to sit there in your room alone and talk to yourself and say it, even though it sounds annoying. And even though it takes like 3 to 4 times as long, because your brain is able to process the thoughts about a slide much more quickly than you are actually able to say them out loud. But you need to. And so you rehearse, rehearse, rehearse at this point. And at this point, it's mostly workshopping. You're just taking little bits and pieces of your lecture, saying them out loud, and seeing, do they work, don't they? Because the next step is to add the flesh. What do I mean by that? Well, what you have up until now is just a skeleton. It's just the bare bones of a lecture. You have facts. Facts are not interesting. You need to add flesh to that skeleton. And that means emotion, stories, rhetoric, evidence, anecdotes. Rob told you the story of his heart attack. That has built-in emotion. If Rob was telling you about a heart attack patient he had, that talk wouldn't have sold. Because, guy had a heart attack. But it's Rob. And there we're hooked. We're there. Because that is emotion. And people want to hear you. They don't want to hear facts. Because what is the major purpose of our lecture? What is number one? Inspire. Absolutely right. People inspire. Facts don't inspire. Stories inspire. So this is what you work on now, is to add you to the mix, add emotion, add stories. Aristotle knew this. He said, if you want to have a good presentation, you need these three things. Okay, just lost it up here if you can, Swami. We need pathos. We need the emotion. We need logos. We need the facts, the proof, the evidence. And we need ethos. We need to embody trust and comfort in the audience for the presenter. All right. The next step is to work the transitions. And this is key. The transitions, your introduction, your conclusion, are what people are going to remember. There's a cognitive process called primacy and another one called recency. The first thing you see when I get up here is going to really color your entire expectations and memory of my talk. If I get up here and I'm a bumbling fool in the first few seconds, that's a really deep hole I have to dig myself out of. And how I close is what you're going to remember. I might have given you the best talk in the world with so many learning points, but if I botched the close, all right, I guess that's all I have. Thanks so much for your attention. That's going to color the entire way you heard about my talk. So your intro, your conclusion, must be worked on at least as hard as everything that's come before. And then the segues, the movement between pieces of the presentation, the smoothness with which you could rehash a point and then logically transition to the next is going to be what adds real elegance to your presentation. And the other thing I add, and I just mentioned this, besides the opening, the closing, and the segues, is the rehash, the really hitting home on the points you want your audience to remember again and again. And it might seem to you, oh, this is too repetitive, I can't keep saying this over and over again. But for the audience, it resonates, it works. And so you figure out what you need them to go home with, and you hit it again and again and again. And then you rehearse out loud, alone, and then you do it again. And then you rehearse again. The mark of an amazing presenter is that they've said the words countless times before they got up there. If you think there's anyone who consistently could make a set of slides and then go give the talk having never said it out loud and that talk to be good, I'd still like to meet that person because I haven't come across them yet. And every presenter that seems so at ease, so capable of ad-libbing, of never preparing their talk, has probably prepared it more extensively than you'd ever be able to imagine. The industry, when they talk about this stuff, says that for every hour of talk, 40 hours of presentation time. It's insane. I can't even do 40 hours, but I certainly don't do one. You need to actually have given this talk countless times before you give it for real. All right, number 7, visualize the visuals. This is the first moment you open a slide program, PowerPoint, Keynote. Before this, no. It's on paper or in other venues that are actually geared towards creativity, that don't lock you in to the slide format. Now is when you decide, do I need visuals? And the reason I say visualize the visuals is as I'm going through my talk during these rehearsals, I say to myself, all right, this point needs a slide. I was talking about a graph. Obviously, I have to put the graph up there. Or I'm talking about a piece of equipment no one's seen before. Okay, I have to show a photo of that piece of equipment. But I write down the areas that absolutely need visuals. And then I ask myself, do I really need anything more than those? And yes, absolutely, I'll add a few more. But the less is more paradigm, not putting visuals in, if they're not absolutely necessary, is going to make your talk leaner. It's going to make it better. It's going to make sure the visuals that are put in actually hit. The other thing I'm willing to put slides in there for is what the presentation gurus call signposting. Giving your audience an idea of where they are in your talk for the same reason that structure relaxes the brain. If you know where I'm actually at in the talk, it makes your brain happier. And if you were looking at your phone for a sec or you had to go to the bathroom and you come back, it realigns you to where you are. It doesn't leave you lost. And if the talk is bombing, it means you know how much more you have to deal with, right? Oh, they're on point 10 of the 12. At least I'm going to get out of here soon. And there's some comfort in that as well. So I'll add these signposting slides. In this lecture, the steps, you know exactly where we are, right? You could even put them on the bottom of your slide. I personally disagree with that. I think it clutters it. But giving people those, you know, way signs to know where they are really makes them feel better. And then you rehearse again. Are you seeing a trend here? Yeah. And then after I've rehearsed it myself at this point with the slides, then my long-suffering spouse gets brought in. And if you don't have a spouse who understands the information you're presenting, my spouse is a pediatric anesthesiologist, so she kind of gets what I'm talking about. She's actually the perfect audience member because she knows enough to really get the concepts, but she knows really none of the deep stuff about emergency medicine or critical care, so she's ideal. She tells me where the things I say are not understandable. But if you don't have a spouse like that, then you need to find a friend or, you know, someone at work who will listen to your talk at this point and tell you where you've gone wrong. And the other thing I do in this rehearsal with an actual person is step number 8. I edit to time. And this is key because there's going to be a lot of stuff in there at this point that you've worked so hard on that gets cut. But you got to do it. Even if it was lovely, even if it was the perfect, you know, slide, you cut it. You kill your darlings, you kill your babies. That's what the authors say. And you do it to get to the point where your talk hits at 3/4 of the time that was allotted to you. So if you were given an hour, you knock your talk down consistently to 45 minutes. 20 minutes, you get it to 15. Now that doesn't mean on the day of that you actually have to give a 45-minute talk in that hour slot. If you did, everyone would love you. No one has ever said, your talk ended early, I'm so disappointed. No, they love you. The conference organizer loves you. The audience loves you. They get to have a little bit of a break. They maybe get to go home early. Or if you wanted to take questions, you had the time. Or your talk may be exactly filling the slot, and you've used that extra quarter to ad-lib, to tell a story, to take questions when you wouldn't, but you could see the audience had something they were burning to ask. You have relaxation. You have freedom, as opposed to, I'm not going to finish my talk in time. I'm not going to finish my talk in time. Don't do it. Just make the talk not close to filling the time, and everything works better. So the 3/4 rule. Now's time for a dress rehearsal, meaning you get in front of a real group where the stakes are not that high, in your suit, with exactly the props, the equipment that you're going to do for the real thing. And it's my long-suffering residents at Stony Brook who get the dress rehearsal of every talk I give. And it's wonderful because they have no problem telling me how much of a boob I am. And I hand them this anonymous feedback form during this dress rehearsal, and I'll get this to you. And I just tell them, please be brutal. Tell me everything that you would fix in this lecture, any points that are not understandable. And then I use that. With that feedback form and the fact that I record the lecture, and all of you have smartphones, and I have links to, you know, $20 tripods that'll fit your smartphone. You all have the capability of recording any lecture you do on the cheap. You don't need that $8,000 camera they have back there. Your smartphone was perfectly adequate. You don't need any special mics or anything. Just set it up and you'll get a recording. And now all of a sudden, when you look at the resident feedback and they say, you know, in that part about the, the blockage of the RCA, I didn't really understand what you were going for there. You go back to the recording, you see how you said it. But it also, it preserves jokes. You know, you never know if the things you say are going to hit or not. And if you get a laugh and you're listening back to your recording, you say, ah, that one's worth using. And the one that fell absolutely flat, you cut. So you record your dress rehearsal, and then you hone. You go back and you say, what actually worked in this real life setting? And then you see if you could add more emotion, more story, more rhetoric, more clarity, and pump it up even further. All right. The other thing I do during this dress rehearsal is step 9. You start thinking about stage markings. What do I mean by this? Well, actors, they all have areas on the stage that they deliberately go to during different parts of the play. If I want to convey more emotion, I'll move close. I'll make my audience uncomfortable. If it's something a little bit, I want to give them a little bit of space, maybe I'll move back here. But it should be conscious. It shouldn't be ad hoc. And what it certainly shouldn't be is, the wandering presenter up front. So you're just actually thinking about your presentation in 3D, thinking about where you are in the room at any given moment. And it might just be one place. That's fine. But actually give it thought. Vic Brazel, who's been at this course before, literally marks the stage with tape every time she gives a presentation and has thought through exactly where she's going to stand for every word of it. So take her example and actually consider how you are going to be presented in whatever stage you're given. All right. The other thing I do from this dress rehearsal is I create a handout. And what all of these national organizations want is they want your slides. And, you know, this quote was actually by me, but I didn't say fracked. They always want my slides. There's nothing good that comes out of my slides. What I want to give them is I want to give them a real handout, something actually meant for it with all the things I discussed. So what I do is during this dress rehearsal, I assign a resident. I ask them, anytime I say, and I'll get you this, I have them write down what I actually said I would get, and then I go home and I actually make a handout. Well, I don't actually make a handout, I make a web page. And here it is for this talk, mcrit.org/presentations. And it has everything you might want for this talk. And just as like a sop, I do put my slides up there, because there are just some people that will like score you incredibly low on your evals if your slides don't exist. But what they actually get is what they should be asking for, which is all of the references, all of the articles, all of the power of the PDFs that I mentioned there in one place. All right, step 11, do it for real. Actually give the talk. It's only step 11, it's not step 12. We'll talk about what's next, but we're gonna give it for real. Record your actual talk, and you'll do it for two reasons. One, it allows you to debrief afterwards, to listen back and say, oh, this worked, this didn't. But the other thing that recording does is when you give this talk again in 2 years, you'll have your slides, but you'll have none of the stories. You'll have none of the anecdotes. You'll have none of the jokes. You'll have none of the emotion. You'll just have your slides. And instead of having to reconstruct that from scratch, you listen, to the talk you gave again, and it all comes back. And you know exactly the things to say to add the flesh to your talk. All right, step 12 is to do it again and again and again. Because the talk is never good the first time. It's never as good as it's going to be. It gets good on the fourth time, the fifth, the sixth. So keep giving that talk, keep making it better, keep updating it for the newest information. But if you're giving one-off talks, then all of that work, those 40 hours for the one-hour talk, they're really for naught. So use it again and again and again. So there you go. The 12 steps to recover from the sickness of bad presentation creation. All of those steps are at mcrit.org/presentations. I'm not going to go through each one again. Bad presentations are a sickness. They're a disease. And it's not about the slides. The slides are only an outward manifestation of that sickness. And the sickness does not just affect the person giving the talk. It's killing people around them. But if you could work on the roots of the problem, if you could fix the fundamentals, then the presentations you create will inspire. They could change the life of the people you speak to. Thank you for your attention.
All right, folks, I hope you enjoyed listening to that as much as I did giving the talk. If you want to hear more about presentations for medical education, there is no better site than the P-Cubed presentation site by my friend Ross Fisher. He is a pediatric surgeon who, through some means, became a guru of all things medical presentations. Now, this is the best site with the worst URL. I think Simon Carley and I have both tried to convince Ross to change the URL to something more fitting to a presentation site, but it is foliate.com. You'll never be able to spell it, so just look here or in the show notes, and you'll be able to find his site and check it out. All right, folks, that's all I got. Scott Weingart, MCRIT Podcast, saying bye-bye.